Well, I was up pretty early this morning and preparing myself, praying for you in this service. As I was doing that, I was also praying for all those people down in Florida and up the East Coast, but especially in Florida that woke up on this Sunday morning. Many of them have lost everything. Many of them have even lost loved ones. I was visiting with someone this morning as they were coming in. They were telling me about their relatives that they have down in Florida, in the Naples area, Fort Myers area, and said their house was spared, just minor damage, but their pastor's house was completely destroyed, lost everything along with their church building, which just reminded me that that story is going to be told literally hundreds of times over of the devastation and the devastation to churches and, of course, pastors and people and believers there. And we want to be praying today for those that really have just really don't know where to turn. And there's so many that are going to be looking for hope, and we know the church will be there for them. Even those like this pastor lost everything, I'm sure that he's probably speaking to his congregation, and probably they're looking at ways that they can serve their community and be Christ to them this morning. So I hope that you'll continue to be praying for all those that have been devastated by Hurricane Ian this past week. So let's pray this morning. Father, you've given us a beautiful, beautiful day, a beautiful Sunday morning to come into your house. And Father, we come in, just in comfort and peace. But we are reminded that there are those, Father, that when they woke up this morning, they woke up to complete devastation, some to really heartbreak and complete loss. Many have lost loved ones, Father, and we pray for all those that have lost family members and loved ones in the pathway of this storm. Father, that you would send those that could speak comfort and hope and peace to those. And Father, those that have lost maybe everything that they've worked for in this life, their homes, their businesses, all of it's just gone. We pray that there'll be those that will come that will be able to meet their needs in the name of Jesus Christ. Pray especially for this pastor. I don't even know, but Father, I know what his heart is like this morning. It's hurting, not just personally, but for his congregation, not just the loss of a church building, but for all those in his church that have really, literally lost homes, possessions, maybe even family members and loved ones, and all the churches and all the pastors that are there, and then all those that are coming into that area to bring relief, to bring hope. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray that you will just strengthen them, give them all the resources that they need. And Father, as your church, may we be faithful to lift them up and to pray and to give, maybe even to go and help in the rebuilding. But Father, we trust all of this to you this morning, and it's in Christ's name we pray. Amen. Amen. Well, I invite you to take your Bibles, open them up to the Gospel of Mark, chapter 8. And we've reached this pivotal point in the Gospel of Mark. Everything is going to get ready to change. Really, the first half of the Gospel, this is really the halfway point, is looking at who Jesus is. But now we make this pivotal turn, and we're going to see why Jesus came. So here's what I want to begin with, just a question for you to be thinking about this morning. What does it mean to be a Christian? What does it mean to be a Christian? And of all people, we should be able to at least give some answer to that question. What does it mean to be a Christian? Now, I can tell you, as you well know, there's a host of ideas and opinions of what it means to be a Christian. Some people would say, well, I'm a Christian because my family's a Christian. I was born into a Christian family. Others would say, oh, I'm a Christian because I was baptized. I was baptized as a baby. I was baptized as a kid. I was baptized in the church. Of course, I'm a Christian. Others would say, well, you know, I belong to a church. I must be a Christian. And, you know, I think there's a lot of people that used to say, well, I'm an American, so I'm a Christian. And somehow being in the West, and particularly in America, somehow culturally and ethically, we were just identified as Christians. Well, we should know, and probably do know, that's not really what it means to be a Christian. But there are different ways of describing Christians. And, you know, I can remember, and I still hear it occasionally, but when someone wants to describe someone that's a Christian, but not just an average Christian, but a really devoted Christian, they will describe them as being a born-again Christian. As if that was one classification of Christian, and there was other classes. But really, being a born-again Christian is the only kind of Christian there really is. Because to be a Christian, it does mean to be born again, we read in John chapter 3. But when we get to the Gospel of Mark, I think we're going to see Jesus is getting ready to tell us what he thinks a real Christian is. And here's what the answer we want to look at this morning is right here. A Christian is someone who is following Jesus. Now, I don't know if that's how you answer that question this morning, but I hope that by the time we're done this morning, it's the answer that you hold to and you believe and find. A Christian is someone who is following Jesus. So just to give you a little review from last week, if you were here, if you weren't, just to kind of take us right in through Gospel of Mark chapter 8 to look at it right here. Jesus was answering this question, dealing with the question, well, who is Jesus? Who is Jesus? And you can get all kinds of answers to that question, but Jesus had taken his disciples and giving them really this final exam after basically 2.5 years with them. They're getting ready now to complete the mission, moving from the Galilee to Jerusalem. It's all coming to really the ahead for why he is here. And what we saw that last week in the answer to this question right here is this is what's important. Who is Jesus? How you answer this question will determine where you will spend eternity. So you can see this question, who is Jesus, is of eternal significance and importance. Who is Jesus? And Jesus gives us that answer. He talks about who he is and why he came, his person, and then his plan and purpose. And so Jesus asks the disciples, what are people saying about me? And in Mark 8, beginning in verse 27. And they said, well, people are saying, well, you're maybe John the Baptist resurrected from the dead, maybe one of the prophets, Elijah, Jeremiah, or some other significant prophet. And so he listens to what people are saying about him. And then he asks them the question, well, who do you say that I am? Now he asks them the personal question. And Peter speaks for the group. Well, you are the Christ. Four words. You are the Christ. Luke records for us, he goes on to say, you are the Christ, the Son of the living God. You are the Messiah. Christ and Messiah, the same word. It's not Jesus' last name. It's his title. He is the Messiah, the Christos, the anointed one. And then he begins to explain to them what that kind of Messiah that he's come to be really is, beginning in verse 31. And so he begins to teach them. And so they can see a little bit, you might say, fuzzy. Jesus is the Messiah. They don't quite have it clearly in focus, the kind of Messiah that he really is. So he began to teach them and to tell them that he's going to suffer and that he's going to be rejected by all the religious authorities in Jerusalem, the elders, the chief priests, the teachers of the law. He goes even farther and tells them, I must be killed. I must be killed. And then after that, 3 days, I will rise again. And he speaks very, very plainly to them and tells them this. And I think the language indicates he was telling them this over a period of time, really wanting it to sink in. You know I'm the Messiah, but let me tell you, I'm not the kind of Messiah that you were anticipating, maybe you were wanting, that you'd be conditioned to believe. I'm going to be a Messiah that doesn't come with political or military power to overthrow the Roman oppressors. I'm a suffering servant Messiah that must die. He tells them what kind of Messiah he must be. Following that really comes the question, well, if Jesus is this kind of Messiah, well, what kind of Christian must I be? What kind of Christian do I have to be? And so Jesus lays it out there. Peter rebuked him strongly. And then, you know, and Jesus said these strong, harsh words to Peter. He said, "Get behind me, Satan," which really Jesus is telling us it's a demonic doctrine, a satanic doctrine that says there is any kind of Christianity and salvation without a cross. And it's really what Satan's always been trying to get forth. He tempted Jesus to avoid the cross, which Jesus wouldn't do. If he couldn't get Jesus to avoid the cross, he'll try to get people to avoid the cross and not really believe that there has to be this kind of cross taking place. And so he explains now what kind of Christian really follows this kind of Messiah. And that's where we pick it up in Mark 8, verse 34. Mark 8, 34. Let me just read the text for you this morning. It says, Then he called the crowd to him along with his disciples. And so there's always been crowds in the first half of the Gospel of Mark. And this is what I want you to see. He's not calling out, you know, the elite, special, committed ones, the disciples. He calls the whole crowd and his disciples to himself and says, "Whoever wants to be my disciple must deny themselves and take up their cross and follow me. For whoever wants to save their life will lose it. Whoever loses their life for me and for the gospel will save it." Let me just ask really a question in terms of profit loss. What good is it for someone to gain the whole world and yet forfeit and lose their soul? Or what can anyone give in exchange for their soul? If anyone is ashamed of me and my words in this adulterous and sinful generation, well, the Son of Man will be ashamed of them when he comes in his Father's glory and with the holy angels. And then he says in chapter 9, verse 1, "Truly I tell you, some who are standing here will not taste death before they see the kingdom of God has come with power." And so Jesus is giving, really, he's just laying it right out there. This is where the rubber meets the road. This is the kind of Messiah I am. What kind of disciple must you be in exchange? Here's the question. What must you do to follow Jesus? What do you have to do to follow Jesus? Now, we usually don't hear the question just exactly like this. We usually hear the question asked by people like me, you know, what do you have to do to be a Christian? But really, it's the same question. What do you have to do to follow Jesus? I mean, this is a significant, significant question. If you really know who Jesus is and how you answer the question, you just don't really stop right there, because that's going to mean something in a very practical way for us, that you must do something. And often we talk about salvation by grace. I'll touch about that. It is salvation by grace. It's by faith. You really don't do anything. You would probably say, well, you have to believe in Jesus Christ. Yes, you do. You really do only have to believe in Jesus Christ as the Son of God who's forgiven you of your sins. But how do you know you really, really believe? You know, I don't know if you've ever noticed this, but especially in this digital age that we live in, there's hardly a day, but a week that doesn't go by that maybe I'm looking to sign up for something, I'm going to subscribe for something, and then as I get right down to kind of closing out the transaction, up pops on the screen the terms and the conditions. Have you ever seen that? Well, you probably see it every day. So here are the terms and the condition for this app or this subscription, this service. These are the terms and the conditions. Now, I'm just going to tell you a little secret. I never read them. And I always check, yes, I did read them, accept the terms, and I move on. I just figure I prolong my life a little bit. I just don't have that much time to waste reading 35 pages of something that I... And I wouldn't advise you doing that. I'm glad you all read all that. But in one sense, this is where Jesus is saying, you want to be a Christian? You want to follow me? There are terms and conditions along with that. Some of you have clicked the box yes and haven't really read it. Jesus is telling us it's really not quite that easy. You believe in me? Do you really believe in me? Oh, you might say you have faith in me, but let me tell you what having in faith in me really means. This is the distinguishing feature of a life that believes in Jesus Christ is in a life that follows him. Now, you understand what I said, right? The distinguishing feature of a life that believes, a person who believes in Jesus Christ, is in a person that follows him. And if someone is not following Jesus Christ, and yet they want to say they believe in Jesus Christ, something isn't quite connected right there. Because you really can't believe in Jesus Christ without following. Jesus talks about it all the time. He gives the most clear teaching of that right here. So you might just ask the question, you know, it's not really a philosophical, hypothetical question. Is can you believe in Jesus Christ without following? Can you believe in Jesus Christ without following him? And I think Jesus is getting ready to answer that question for us real clearly so we can understand it right here. And so he begins to talk about in verse 34, you might say these, and I just want to call them three terms, conditions, demands. You know, we hardly ever even talk about the demands of the Christian life. It's just sort of, hey, do you believe in Jesus? Yeah, I believe in Jesus. Does he make a difference in your life? Oh, not really. You know, I still live the life I want to. I belong to all the same social clubs. I'm all the same circle. It really doesn't make any difference in my life. It's just something I've added to my life. Just a sort of a little backup insurance policy. It looks good. I try to be a better person. But here Jesus says these are certain terms and conditions of what it means to really believe in him and follow him. So he called the crowd together and his disciples in verse 34 and begins to tell them, whoever wants to be my disciple. Now, a disciple, you might think, well, you know, I don't know if I want to be a disciple. I think I just want to be just an average Christian that kind of gets into heaven. Well, we're not given that luxury of choices of what kind of Christian. Every Christian is a disciple. It just means a follower. This is a learner. Anyone who wants to be a Christian must, first of all, deny yourself. So what must you do to follow Jesus? Well, let's begin with number one. Deny yourself. Deny yourself. It's Jesus and not self. And we're talking about the idol of self. Really, it's the idol of self. And self-idolatry here that Jesus is talking about. So that word deny says you must deny yourself. Means to refuse. It means to disown. It means to renounce. And when you think about denial in the New Testament, you probably have this image of Peter on the night that Jesus was betrayed. And Peter denied him. So well, I don't know him. You know, I don't have anything to do with him. I'm not associated with him. Well, that word means that we make a decision about self. I'm denying myself. I'm disowning myself. It's it's not really self-denial as we think of it. It's denial of self. You know, we think about self-denial. We often think about, well, I'm going to refuse to have something that I really want or like. I'm going to deprive myself of something. I'm going to give up chocolate. I'm not going to eat this. I'm going to deny myself. That's not what he's talking about here. It's denying self. And denying self is really the decision to dethrone self from the throne of our life. That no longer is self in control. It is letting go of personal rights and cutting off ownership of self. It's the idea of control. Who controls my life? Me or Christ? That's what he's talking about. Who controls my life? Who sits on the throne? And so he says, dethrone yourself. There is another king of your life, and it's not you. Paul talked about it this way in 1 Corinthians 6. He says, you do not belong to yourself, for God bought you with a high price. When you become a Christian, you have to realize you've been purchased. And whoever purchases you owns you. And so Christ now owns us. And so we deny ourselves. It really is a prayer every day. Father, glorify yourself in my life today at my expense. Glorify yourself at my expense. And so the first condition is denying self. Denying self. Now the second one is you take up your cross. Deny yourself and take up your cross. And this somehow has worked its way into, you know, vernacular of everyday language, because people often talk about, well, they've got some type of hardship, some type of burden in their life, and they just refer to, well, it's my cross to bear. It's the cross I'm having to bear. That's not what he's talking about right here. He's talking about denying yourself, you choose Jesus over self. He's talking about here, you choose the cross over life. Because you have to remember, when Jesus is speaking these words and he says to them, take up your cross, this is before the crucifixion. This is before Jesus' crucifixion, but it's not before crucifixions. The Romans had taken this ancient form of execution, probably from Persia, and they had just perfected it. And literally, in the first century, the Romans were crucifying untold millions of people. My guess is there's probably very few days that would ever go by in the Galilee, or even especially down in Judea, that you wouldn't see people crucified by the Romans along the side of the road. The cross was this instrument of death. Really, the cross is synonymous with death. And so he's not talking about some hardship, some trouble that you have to endure in life. When Jesus says, take up your cross, this is pretty radical. It's radical. He says, not only do you deny yourself, you've got to put yourself to death. You really have to take up your cross and crucify this idea of self-rights, self-promotion, and ultimately self-centeredness. That it really is what you want. And you know this story from the crucifixion of Jesus, but this is what would be in their mind, because they had seen, no doubt, dozens if not hundreds of crucifixions that Jesus is speaking to this crowd, that when a condemned person was going to the place of crucifixion, they were made to carry the cross beam or the cross. And so Jesus wasn't the only one that had done that. That's literally how crucifixions were done. The condemned person, being put to death, would carry their cross. And so you'd see this person that would be stumbling down the road. They'd have this cross beam of the cross maybe across their shoulders and probably at the edge of death already, and just pulling that cross that was ultimately going to be their place of death, or going to their own death. You can imagine what kind of scene that must have been. And this is what happens when you see someone carrying their cross on the way to the place of crucifixion, you begin to realize that person is walking in a one-way direction and is never coming back. That's what it means to follow Jesus. You walk in a one-way direction, crucifying the self, never coming back. You're never coming back. Self-centeredness dies. And Paul said it this way in Galatians 2:20. He says, I've been crucified with Christ, and I no longer live. No, Paul does live physically, but spiritually he says, I've crucified the self. I've denied myself. I've taken up the cross. He's at the center of my life. Christ lives in me. The life I now live is in the body. I live by faith in the Son of Jesus, in the Son of God who gave himself for me. He loved me and gave himself for me. So what's Jesus saying? If you're going to follow me, you have to deny yourself. You have to take up your cross. And I think Matthew or Luke adds to that, you have to take it up every day. So this is an everyday thing that has to take place, because every day I find myself wanting to come back to the old life and the old self. So I have to be crucified every day. And so now this third condition, which really might just be the result of these first two, is you have to obey Christ. And this is where he says, take up your cross, deny yourself, and follow me. And so if you take up your cross and deny yourself, I think the result of that is you are following him. But for our purposes, the idea of following Jesus means, the word means to go with. It means to imitate. It's the idea of obedience. I will be obedient to him. I will imitate him. I will follow him. It's this idea of devoted obedience to Christ. Deny yourself. Take up your cross. Crucify the self. Die to self. And follow Jesus. Matthew 10:38, Jesus said, whoever does not take up their cross and follow me is not worthy of me. Now, he said, it's not like this is optional. What did he just say? If you do not take up your cross and follow me, Jesus says, you're not worthy of me. So it's not like, well, I don't know. That seems kind of radical. Taking up a cross, following Jesus. That's a little much. And Jesus just says, you can say with your mouth that Jesus Christ is your Lord and Savior. But if you only honor me with your lips and not your life, you're not worthy of me. He says in Luke 14:33, so you cannot become my disciple without giving up everything you own, including self. And Jesus sort of just precludes this idea that, you know, I can have a little bit of Jesus with a little bit of everything else in my life. He says, no. This becomes pretty radical. It's everything. Now, what's fascinating in the tenses of the verbs that are used there, they are present tense verses that indicate this is continuous action. So it's something like this is what Jesus is saying. You want to be a Christian, you want to be one of my followers, you keep on denying yourself, you keep on taking up your cross, and you keep on obeying Christ. And you do it every day. You do it today, you do it the next day, the day after that. You just keep on doing that. And so that's what we begin to understand, that to follow Jesus at all cost, because he is the only way of salvation. And so he's this pearl of great price. We would give up everything for this. We follow him completely. Now what Jesus says, this is really sort of this a real short terms and conditions right here. Deny yourself, take up your cross, follow me, obey me. But then he gives us this sort of the motivation then that comes. If you're going to do that, you should know there's something that you get out of it. You get something in return. These are sort of the implications or the promises that come out of that. These are the three promises of discipleship. So here's promise number one. You will find your life. you will find your life. In other words, there is a change in the way that you view life. Now, as Christians, we look at life, we view life differently than non-Christians. Jesus says that if you follow me, in verse, whoever wants to save their life will lose it. In other words, those who are trying to get all of this life they can now, they're going to lose it. But whoever will lose their life for my sake is going to find it. And so what he's saying to them, that if you focus on yourself and your own life, you're going to lose it. You won't ultimately keep it. But if you lose your life for Christ and the gospel, you will save it. That's exactly what you get. The very thing that you want, you're going to lose if you don't give this ultimate allegiance to Christ, regardless of what you think the cost might be. Now, Paul realized this. In Acts 20, verse 24, Paul just ultimately says near the end of his life, but my life is worth nothing to me. My life's worth nothing to me unless I use it for finishing the work assigned to me by the Lord Jesus Christ. For Paul, this was, everything else had become garbage to Paul. Only giving my life to Christ and the purpose he created me for, the work of telling others the good news about the wonderful, wonderful grace of Jesus Christ. And so Paul says, I kind of understand that I found my life in the gospel. I found my life in Christ. It changes the way that you view life. Now the second promise is, not only will you find your life, but you get to keep your soul. You get to keep your soul. That's interesting because this is a change. What happens is there comes a change in your view of what is worth giving your life to and for. And so all of us really have to at some point ask ourselves, you know, what am I living for? What am I giving my life to? What am I chasing? What am I chasing, and is it really worth it? Because then you have to kind of weigh out the value of your soul, which is the eternal part of who we are. So this is the part that lives for eternity. So he says, whoever wants to save their life will lose it. Whoever loses their life, what good is it for someone to gain the whole world? I mean, get rich, have all kinds of possessions, be in all kinds of power. And the trade-off for that is your soul. And the implication is, well, it's a very, very bad exchange that you've been given your life for something that soon will be gone. And then the third implication he gives us here in closing is that you will enter glory. You will enter glory. And so you kind of come down to verse 38. You know, if he says, if anyone is ashamed of me and my gospel and my words, if you're ashamed of me in this adulterous and sinful generation, I mean, this is this evil generation that rejects me, well, the Son of Man will be ashamed of them too when he comes in his Father's glory with the holy angels. That there is this appointed time when the Lamb will be a lion, he's going to return, time will be no more, and he basically just says, if you're ashamed of me, well, I'll be ashamed of you. And the word ashamed means to despise or to reject or refuse to accept. And so he sort of gives these two thoughts. You ashamed of me in my words, the gospel? He's saying you deny me, you really don't want to live this way, you don't want to believe this, behave this way. You're denying me by the way that you live. He says, secondly, well, I'll be ashamed of you. At my return, when time is no more, we enter into eternity, I'll be ashamed of you. And so I'm just going to close with this thought. I think the most dangerous temptation that any human being could ever have, this is the most dangerous temptation, is the temptation to believe and to live like there is no eternity. If somehow Satan can just get you to believe there's really no forever and this is all that there is, he's got you. But when you really believe there is something more forever, and this is just that brief time of preparation leading into that, we quit doing what so many Christians are doing, that's treating our faith like a hobby. And if Christianity is a hobby, you'll never make it, because it gets too hard and too tough. You don't deny yourself. You don't die to yourself when it's just a hobby. When it quits being fun, enjoyable, and beneficial, I'm done with it. And we see it happen every day. Every day. And what Jesus is saying here, that everyone needs Jesus. Everyone needs to know about Jesus. One day we're going to stand before Jesus. That's the way he's saying, I'm going to return. And I'm going to return in glory. I'm going to turn to holy angels. One day you'll stand before me. Do you believe in me? So yeah, I believe in you. Well, the distinguishing mark is someone who believes in Jesus, someone who's following Jesus. Are you following him? Are you really committed to him? That's not really a hard question to answer, because it doesn't take long to look at your life and see where you're spending your time, where you're spending your money, and more. But, you know, that's, you want to look, what's your commitment? And you begin to ask yourself, is this just a hobby? Or is this life and death for me? And I got thinking about this week. Many of you don't know, but a lot of you do know that George Beverly Shea, at every Billy Graham crusade, he'd always sing Just As I Am. But also when he'd sing Just As I Am somewhere during the crusade, he'd sing that great hymn, I'd rather have Jesus than silver or gold. I'd rather have him than riches untold. I'd rather have Jesus than worldwide fame. I'd rather be true to his holy name than be the king of a vast domain. I'm going to ask you to bow when he's praying. And if you want to follow Jesus, believe in him and follow him today, I'm right up here this morning. I want to pray with you and explain to you and help you make that decision if you've not done that. And for some of us here, many of us here, it's just a decision of where we have to determine, am I denying myself? Am I taking up my cross? Am I following him? Because there is an eternity that's coming. Father, I pray you'll move among us today. We give our lives to you. We'd rather have you than anything this world could give us. And I pray every one of us will leave today as followers of yours. And it's in Christ's name we pray. Amen.